Benvenuti a questa sessione. Mi sembra che possiamo parlare in italiano almeno per le presentazioni. Otherwise, we may switch to English if I'm missing anybody who doesn't speak Italian, but maybe not. Allora, la sessione durerà dalle 9 alle 11, è Multi-Agent Systems One. Avremo sei presentazioni, ciascuna presentazione deve durare 15 minuti. Quindi darò un warning, forse direi al 15° minuto se qualcuno va oltre, e lasceremo 5 minuti di domande. Quindi la sessione durerà fino alle 11. Adesso c'è uno staff tecnico che ci aiuta, giusto? E questo è.
Sì, sono Mauro Franceschelli di
Ok,
Unica.
Mauro, grazie Mauro. Preferisco chiamare Mauro piuttosto che spiaggia del Poetto. Grazie. E grazie a tutti per la partecipazione. Allora, direi che possiamo iniziare con la prima presentazione, che peraltro è un paper di cui sono coautore, presentato dal mio dottorando Riccardo Bertollo. Buongiorno Riccardo. E il titolo è Uniform Global Asymptotic Synchronization of Kuramata Oscillators via Hybrid Coupling. E chiederei a chi non parla di mettersi in muto, ovviamente.
Ok, allora condivido lo schermo con le slide. Ok, quindi posso partire?
Sì, parti pure, Riccardo.
Okay, so good morning, everybody. Today I would like to talk to you about a research that I carried out with the help of Elena Pantelei, Roman Postoyan, and Luca Zakarian, who I would like to thank very much, about the Kuramata model, and in particular on how the hybrid coupling helps solving the issue of non-uniform convergence that the Kuramata model presents in its original form. So let's start by quickly overviewing the original Kuramata model, which was proposed in 1975 by Yoshiki Kuramoto and describes a system of interconnected oscillators with all-to-all layout. So each oscillator is connected to each of the others. So the
Scusate,
derivative of the.
fermo un attimo Riccardo perché io vedo uno schermo nero. Voi vedete
Sì, non si
un'immagine?
vedono. Ok, ora si vedono le slide.
Ok, allora magari lascio non full screen.
Ok,
Forse c'è il problema. Ok.
perfetto, scusatemi. Vai avanti Riccardo.
So the derivative of the phase of each oscillator is described as its natural frequency plus a function of the phase difference with all the other oscillators, which is in the original model the sine function. The model has gained increasing interest in the scientific community because of the high number of applications you can see here in biology, physics, engineering, and recently also in automatic control. And at the same time, studies were carried out on its stability properties or on more complex network structures or coupling gains. Concerning the stability properties, the model presents uniform global stability properties, but not uniform global asymptotic stability. This is because the coupling function vanishes at pi, so the system possesses multiple equilibria. The consequence is clearly seen in the case of two oscillators. You can see here an example of a simulation, and you can see that the closer the phase difference starts to pi, the longer it will take for the phases to actually converge. And this is a typical example of non-uniform convergence. And while this is okay if you want to describe existing phenomena, the most famous example is the one of synchronizing metronomes on a moving platform, which behave exactly like this. It is less suitable if you want, for example, to design a controller. And a typical example where this is an issue is the control of unstable aircrafts. Unfortunately, this non-uniform convergence is not avoidable if you are using a continuous approach. Indeed, as you can see in the plot down here with the orange dotted line, if we need to have stable equilibria at every multiple of 2 pi, because of continuity, we will have at least one point in the middle, in this case pi, where the coupling function vanishes. This can be solved if we use a hybrid approach, because thanks to jump in the state variables, we can force the domain of the coupling function to be a compact set, for example, as we did in this green coupling function. So we can be sure that the only point where the function is zero is actually the point zero, so the synchronization configuration. Other than this property, the coupling function needs to have some other properties in order to be able to prove asymptotic stability. As I said, we need to have a compact domain. We chose to have the interval minus pi minus delta, pi plus delta, where delta is a positive scalar, which, as we will see, will prevent zero solutions. Moreover, we need to have an odd function, which always have the same sign of its argument. Here you have some example of the coupling functions we used in the simulation later. You can see that this saturation-like and the ramp function respect the given properties, while the sinusoidal function, which is in the original model, does not. To ensure that the domain is compact, we will need to, as I said, introduce jumps in the phases, and when the phases are subject to jumps, we will need to keep track on their unwinding through a discrete state K12. So let's jump into the description on the model, and let's start from the case of two oscillators with the continuous evolution or flow in the hybrid system terminology, because it's the most intuitive. We want to have a system that behaves exactly like the Kuramoto model near the equilibrium the synchronization configuration, because the original model behaves well in that region, but we want to avoid the non-uniform convergence issue. So what we do is we use exactly the same dynamics, continuous dynamics, but we substitute the sine function with a coupling function sigma, which satisfies the given properties. Notice that in this work, we use the oscillators with the same natural frequency. And also notice that in the argument of sigma, other than the phase difference, we also have 2 pi multiplied by K12, which is the discrete state I was mentioning. And that with the jump rules that we will see later, will ensure that when we are flowing, we have the norm of the argument of sigma, which is smaller than pi plus delta. To complete the dynamics, we add the continuous evolution of K12, which being discrete has derivative equal to zero. Next, we have the jump dynamics, which follow mainly two rules. The first one is to keep the norm of each phase smaller than pi plus delta, and to this end, we introduce jumps of 2 pi whenever a phase is bigger than, has norm bigger than pi plus delta. And you can see these sets in red and green in this projection of the space of the state space on the theta 1 theta 2 plane. The second jump rule is, as I said already two times, to keep the norm of the argument of sigma smaller than pi plus delta, and is achieved through this jump set D12 and this jump map. This is not really intuitive when you look at the formula, but can be seen intuitively in the graphical representation. You can see that the flow set is the white one, and on the diagonal you have the argument of sigma. And in this example with k equal to zero, you can see that the norm of the argument is smaller than pi plus delta. And the same goes in this case where k is equal to one. To conclude the formulation, we just need to write the data in the general form that is written down here. The flow map was already defined explicitly, while the simplest way to define the jump map is through the union of the graphs of the single jump maps that we defined in the previous slides. Concerning the jump set and the flow set, we first need to define the flow state space, so the phases will evolve in the interval minus 2 pi to pi, while the discrete state K12 is an integer between minus 2 and 2. Once we did this, we can define the jump set as the union of all the partial jump sets, and the flow set as the closure of the difference between the whole state space and the jump set, which is a formulation that prioritizes jumps over flows. The model we just defined has some nice properties. So the first one is that it satisfies the hybrid basic conditions as defined in the hybrid system book by Goebbels, San Felice and Thiel. Therefore, it is well posed, which has some regularity implications, such as sequential compactness of solutions or intrinsic robustness of asymptotic stability. Moreover, as you may know, it's not always true that solutions to hybrid system evolve forever so that they are complete. But in this case, we can prove that for every initial condition, we have at least one complete solution. And additionally, we don't have complete solutions that only jumps according to G1 and D2. And this wouldn't be possible if we didn't introduce the space regularization delta, because in that case, we would have solutions with phases that continuously jump between minus pi and pi. The last thing is that we can indeed prove that thanks to G12, when we are flowing, so when we are in C, the argument of the norm of the argument of sigma is smaller than pi plus delta. And as I said again, we can see this intuitively from the graphical representation. Now let's move to the main result of this work, which is that the synchronization set is uniformly globally pre-asymptotically stable for the proposed system. We added the prefix pre again consistently with the hybrid system book to highlight that some solutions are not complete, but the complete solutions asymptotically converge to the attractor. And again, I want to underline that UGPAS comprises uniform global stability, which is already enjoyed by the Kuramoto model, and uniform global preact activity, which is the main contribution of the work. Also, because of well-posedness that we highlighted earlier, we can say that A is robustly pre-asymptotically stable, which could be useful for practical applications. Now, just to give you an idea of the proof technique, we used a weak Lyapunov function V of X defined as the integral of sigma between zero and a saturation of its argument. And we can prove that this function is strictly decreasing along flowing solutions and that it is non-increasing across jumps in the solution for outside of a superset A prime of A. This non-strict decrease across jumps calls for the use of an invariance principle. And indeed, we can prove that no solution keeps V to a constant non-zero value for all the forward hybrid times. Therefore, we can say that A prime is UGPAS for the system. Lastly, we can use a reduction theorem to join the fact that A prime is UGPAS for the whole system and A is UGPAS from A prime to conclude that A itself is UGPAS for the whole system. Here you can see the result of some simulations. Here we started from a phase difference close to pi using the coupling function that I mentioned earlier and that are reported here in top right. And you can see that with the sinusoidal function, we have the stickiness effect, which is typical of non-uniform convergence. Whereas with the function that respect the given properties, so the red one and the green one, we have asymptotic convergence as expected. Then we performed a simulation from a smaller initial angle, so pi over 4 in this case, and the system and the coupling function behave exactly the same, which was, again, our initial goal. Now let's see briefly how we can extend this dynamics, this description to any connection layout. We can do so through undirected graphs, and indeed we can describe oscillators through nodes and connection through edges. Then we need to define an orientation, to choose an orientation to define the incidence matrix B of the graph. Which orientation to choose is still under investigation because we believe that the appropriate choice of the orientation would be paramount to be able to extend the stability theorem to the general case. Moreover, we introduce a notation simplification. So we define the sigma, the coupling function acting between oscillator I and J as sigma ij, and we collect them in a vector sigma ordered like the columns of B. Once we did this, we can use the sign convention to apply sigma ij with a plus sign to the starting node and with a minus sign to the end node. And we can write the derivative of the phase vector in this compact way where one of n is a vector of dimension n with all ones. Then we add the derivative of the vector k, which is a vector because of course to any every connection ij corresponds a discrete state kij, which is zero for all the elements. Now the jump rule is pretty convoluted in terms of notation, but the idea is exactly the same as the two oscillators case. So we have one first jump rule which keeps the norm of each phase smaller than pi plus delta, and the second jump rule which keeps the norm of the argument of each sigma ij smaller than pi plus delta. Generalization of the theorem and its proof have not been carried out yet, but we performed the simulations with the original Kuramoto model and our model. This is a case of a connected undirected graph, and we can see that in the original Kuramoto model, we have some phase difference which do not converge to zero. They stay around the value of pi, whereas with our model, all the phase difference converge to zero asymptotically. So we believe that starting from a connected undirected graph and choosing in a smart way the orientation, we will be able to extend the proof of the stability theorem to the general case. So to conclude, we effectively proved the uniform global asymptotic stability of the synchronization set in the two oscillators case for any coupling function which satisfies the given properties, and simulation confirmed this result. The generality of the proof technique and the positive result of simulations suggest a possible extension to the general case of the stability theorem, whereas other possible developments could be relaxing the requirements on sigma. For example, we believe that the odd function requirement could be removed somehow, or studying the case of oscillators with different natural frequency, or again, treating the case of disconnected graphs or directed graphs where the connection happens only from one oscillator to the other. So this is the end of the presentation. I thank you all for your attention, and I'm happy to answer any questions if there are.
Thank you, Riccardo. Thank you for being in time, despite a bit delay in the beginning. So do we have any questions from the audience? Okay, no questions. I wonder.
No, no, there is one. There is one.
Oh yeah, very nice. Oh yeah, thanks. Go ahead, Diego. And I think we're not many, so you guys can unmute your microphone directly.
Okay, thanks. I'm sorry, I had to disconnect it, so I couldn't talk. So actually, you are considering monotone coupling functions, right? So you keep the central part as the same as in the Kuramoto model, and then you saturate the final part. So actually, yes, the coupling function is monotone, right?
Yes.
So have you read and do you know about the work of Sepulcre with the monotone functions? Because
no.
they provided a solution. Okay, this keyword can be useful for you maybe for further investigation.
Okay.
And so actually it's not exactly a question, just a discussion about if you have considered the fact mm-hmm. that you are considering monotone function.
Mm-hmm.
But actually, so what I think is that the stability of the origin
mm-hmm.
comes from the fact that the function is strictly monotone around that manifold. And so I believe that the theorem you presented is true, because I think it's a kind of a generalization of
mm-hmm.
the stability of the synchronization manifold. And I don't know if you have any investigation about the other possible stable equilibrium that can arise from these coupling functions. Have you any investigation about that?
If I understood correctly the question, while proving the theorem, we only had this equilibrium configuration, so the only stable point was the origin. If I remember correctly, because I haven't seen the proof for a while now, the monotonicity is not strictly required, but it's sufficient to have a function which you can see in the item 2 has the same sign of its argument, because there is an integral in the proof. So I believe also with non-monotone function this could work. For example, let's take the sinusoidal function, but just before it hits zero we keep it to a constant value, slightly positive, the proof would work, the system would converge to zero uniformly, maybe slowly.
Okay, I see. So the problem is not the monotonicity, but okay, not the problem. The fact is to be considered is not the monotonicity, but actually the positivity of the function between
yes.
zero and pi plus delta, right?
Yes, exactly.
Okay, it can be. I'm not sure, but thanks for the feedback.
No problem.
Yeah, I would like to add that it's interesting the observation of Diego about using monotonicity, and indeed all solutions should contract to this uniform, you know, to this unique motion, which is essentially a one-dimensional manifold, the consensus manifold. So the tools of Sepulcre and Forni, I think, you know, those of contraction could be used, but you know, we haven't thought about using those tools for the proofs. It might be a useful suggestion for the, you know, higher number of agent generalization.
Yeah, maybe we can talk about in another moment, because I'm also working on monotonic function coupling the kind of Kuramoto model, so it could be interesting. Nice. But thank you for the feedback.
Thanks. Okay, so I think we should move on to the next talk. We are a few seconds late. So I would ask the next speaker, who is probably Luca Patané.
Yes.
So Luca is gonna talk about work on the role of static and dynamic coupling in chaos synchronization. And I think Luca, you can go ahead, you can share your screen. You can try to go full screen. Let's see if it works for your connection. It didn't work for Riccardo.
Yeah, I will try.
Yeah. We'll give you feedback about whether we see your slides or not. We still see your power.
I have a message. I'm not able to start my video.
It's okay. We can see. Oh, you mean your face. It's okay. We can see the slides. And that's
probably... Yeah.
So we can see the slides.
The privilege to do that. I don't know why now. Of course, I can start.
So it's okay. You can start. You can start your speech.
Yeah. Thank you very much for the introduction. So my name is Luca Patané. I'm a researcher at the University of Messina. And this work was developed together with Arturo Buscarino and other colleagues from University of Catania. Now a brief summary of the presentation. So I will talk about synchronization, in particular complete synchronization in master-slave systems, the mathematical tools that will be used in order to study the synchronization are related to the Lyapunov theory for linear system with nonlinear vanishing perturbations. In particular, we will take care of the analysis of the linear components of the error systems by applying some root locus strategies in order to evaluate synchronization in chaotic systems, even if the strategy can be applied also on other nonlinear systems. And we will evaluate different coupling strategies, starting from the classical static coupling, and then we will study the different results obtained using some dynamic coupling approach, simple linear dynamic coupling, also looking to the possibility to improve the obtained properties in synchronization when higher order coupling is included. And then we proposed a mixed solution that can improve both the transient time and the stability region for the coupling parameters. A few words about the related background. So different techniques can be used to study synchronization, starting from the well-known mass stability function. But synchronization can be studied also as an optimization problem, for instance, when a system can be written in Lure form, or using Jaskorin theorem together with linear matrix inequalities. In our case, we will use the Lyapunov theory for perturbed system in order to analyze synchronization in chaotic systems. A few words about master-slave synchronization. Here you can see the classical scheme. We have master and slave system, two identical systems. And the information about the error on the state variables is used in order to guide the dynamic of the slave. And here we have the K that represents the coupling parameter. And we will obtain complete synchronization when the error between master and slave state variables tend to zero in time. When dynamic coupling is considered, we added a block in the scheme, as you can see here, where a linear dynamic coupling system is introduced and in some way mediates the error information that is used to guide the dynamic of the slave system. In the questions, you can see here that, for instance, a simple first order linear dynamics can be used, but we will see that also other order can be adopted for the coupling system. For sake of clarity, in the following slide, we will consider the cases in which the error between a single set variable of the systems is used to control a single equation in the slave. So we will have just a single component for the error and a single equation of the slave system involved in the coupling scheme. So the Lyapunov approach can guarantee sufficient condition for the stability of the synchronization error dynamics. As you can see here, we will identify inside the error dynamics between master and slave state variables, linear components where we can identify the associated state matrix, and then nonlinear function that includes all the nonlinearities present in the question. And here you can see how the controller systems, in the case of static and dynamic coupling, behaves in terms of state matrix. So we will evaluate the what we call the A tilde matrix that for the dynamic couplings is represented by a block size matrix that consider a generalized error vector that include also the dynamics of the linear coupling system. In order to evaluate the stability of the synchronization manifold, we have to verify that the linear part of the error system is stable, so matrix A tilde needs to be Hurwitz, that the perturbation is vanishing, so when the error is zero, also the function G is zero too, and we have to impose a linear growth bound condition, so we have to limit the evolution of the nonlinear components, and here we can identify a parameter gamma that is related to the maximum eigenvalue of the matrix P that is the solution of the Lyapunov equation associated to the matrix A tilde. About the analysis of the linear part, in the case of the static coupling, we can verify that the matrix A tilde is Hurwitz, evaluating the characteristic polynomial and applying the matrix determinant lemma, we can rewrite the polynomial as a function of the characteristic polynomial of the matrix A and an element that is related to the here reported aggregate matrix, and the element we have to consider in this matrix is related to which variable we are connecting between master and slave. And finally, this demonstration will be shown as demonstrate the stability of this closed loop system, where we can identify the coupling parameter K, and in the feedforward chain, we have a transfer function that depends on the characteristic polynomial of the matrix A and the element of the aggregate matrix we are considering. In the case of dynamic coupling, we have to apply the property of the Schur complement in order to perform some mathematical steps that allow us to demonstrate that we have to verify the stability of this closed loop scheme, where we have, together with the previous elements introduced in the static coupling, another block that depends on the linear dynamical coupling system we are including, where lowercase m is the order of the linear coupling system. I can now try to apply this strategy to the well-known Rösler system. It is a chaotic oscillator. We need to identify inside the dynamics of the error system. So we have two identical Rösler oscillators connected in a master slave wave. We can identify the linear component and the nonlinear part, the nonlinear perturbation. We can easily verify that this perturbation is vanishing, and we can evaluate the characteristic polynomial of the matrix A together with the needed aggregate matrix in order to study the stability in case of static coupling. So for instance, if we consider a coupling one in one, so we are taking the error between the first state variables of the two systems and we are feeding it inside the first equation of the slave system, we have just to select the first element of the aggregate matrix. We can derivate the transverse function, and we can study the analysis of the stability of this block scheme by using the root locus strategy. And here you can see that from the root locus, we can identify a stable region for the stability. And so the coupling gain K needs to be between 0.2 and 5. Of course, we have to verify also the last condition related to the linear growth bound for the perturbation. Here you can see in the first plot the relation between the parameter K and the parameter gamma, that is part of the inequality we have to verify. If, for instance, we take the peak of this curve, and so we select this parameter for the gain, we can see in simulation that the system can synchronize in time, as we can see looking to the root mean square error, and also the inequality is verified in time for the selected initial conditions. About the initial condition, we have to understand which are the role of this, which are the role of this condition in that case. And so we performed some numerical analysis in order to verify where this linear growth bound condition is verified. As you can see here in this graph, we have in red reported the dynamical evolution of the master system, so the Rossler attractor. And then we selected a series of points inside this trajectory, and we verified the linear growth bound condition. And so we placed the state variable of the slave system in a cube centered in the selected point, and with side equal to 2. And as you can see here in green, you can see the domain where the condition is verified for the considered cases. Now we want to understand if the static coupling is able to accomplish synchronization in every case. We selected a different coupling scheme, so we are now using the error between the second state variable of the master and slave in order to guide the evolution of the first equation of the slave system. What will change is only the selection of the element in the aggregate matrix, and so we will have a different transverse function, as here you can see in the root locus plot, that in this case, we are not able to find a stable region for the coupling gain. Instead, if we introduce a simple first order linear dynamical coupling, we can modify the transfer function, adding a pole to the system. And as you can see here in the root locus, we are able to identify a stable region for negative value of K. Of course, by changing the parameters, in the previous case, the parameter alpha was imposed equal to 1, we will obtain different portrait in the root locus. And so we can mathematically derive which is the stable region that will depend on both the parameter alpha and K. And so here you can see in the plot the stability region for the linear system that we identified together with the corresponding value of the parameter gamma needed to verify the linear growth bound condition. So basically, we demonstrated that in some cases, the static coupling is not able to fulfill the task in order to synchronize master and slave system, but a dynamic solution can solve the problem. Now we want to understand if the order of the dynamical coupling system can have a role and can further enhance the obtained results. So in this case, we considered the same configuration as before. We considered the second order linear coupling system that is something like a spring damping system that mediates the information between master and slave. And we can analyze the characteristic polynomial. In this case, the free available parameter will govern the position of 1, 0 and 2 poles in the transfer function. And looking to the root locus analysis, we will see that we are able to we are able to modify the portrait in order to improve the synchronization performance. As you can see here on the right side, there is a statistical analysis about the synchronization time. As you can see, we are able to enhance the synchronization time introducing the second order dynamical coupling if compared to the first order dynamical coupling, remembering that in this case a static solution, so a static coupling, is not able to fulfill the task. Now we try to go further ahead and we proposed a mixed solution. So the idea is to consider both a static coupling and a dynamic coupling. This scheme is reported just a simple first order linear dynamical coupling system. And by adopting this solution, we are able to further improve the obtained results. As you can see here in this root locus plot, for the same configuration as before, so 2-in-1 for the Rosler oscillator, we are able to identify an open region for the stability, and so we are able to eliminate the lower bound for the coupling parameter. This can be seen also in the graph on the right, where the relation between the parameter K and the parameter gamma is reported. And this is very important, in particular, when synchronization in networks is considered, because in that case, we need to satisfy that the eigenvalue of the Laplacian matrix need to behave to the stability region of the coupling parameters. So in this case, we have more degree of freedoms in order to satisfy this condition. Now I want just to apply the same mechanism to another system in order to summarize the obtained results. In this case, we are talking about the HR neuron, also behaving in a chaotic attractor. And so we will follow the same passages as before. So we need to identify the state matrix. We need to demonstrate that the perturbation is vanishing. And then we can calculate the characteristic polynomial, the aggregate matrix. And finally, as you can see here, we can plot the different root locus shapes. And each subplot is related to the different elements we are connecting between master and slave. So look into this.
Luca, I would ask you to wrap up a bit because you got to 15 minutes.
But sure, sure. It's the last slide before the conclusion. So I'm okay. So basically, in these two cases, so 2-in-1 and 2-in-3, we have zero element in the aggregate matrix. And so it's not able to, we are not able to apply the proposed strategy. In this case, so 2-in-2, we have already, by using the static coupling, an open region, as we can see here from the root locus analysis. In the other cases, 3-in-1 and 1-in-3, we are in a condition with some vertical asymptotes that are similar to the Rosler case. And in this case, we apply the mixed coupling solution. And as you can see here, we are able to obtain an open region for the coupling gain, and we are able to modify the synchronization time by changing the parameter K depending on the needs. Just to conclude, I want to summarize that we are proposing a design strategy for a master slave coupling mechanism based on Lyapunov theory for perturbed systems. We investigated the role of static and dynamic coupling also in relation with the transient time for reaching synchronization. And finally, we proposed a mixed coupling solution that is able to provide open region for the coupling gain in some cases. And this is a key advantage for network synchronization. If you are interested for further details, you can have a look to this recent publication on the related to this topic. Thank you very much for your attention.
Okay, thank you, Luca. We do have a very, very short time for one short question. So Mattia Frasca wants to ask a question, please.
Yes, first of all, congratulations. It's a very nice work where you demonstrate the usefulness of a dynamic coupling. This is very, very interesting point. I have just two quick curiosities. Have you applied the approach for bidirectional coupling? This is the first curiosity. And the second
actually,
one...
let's go only for the first curiosity. We have 1 minute for
okay.
the answer.
Okay.
I'm sorry, but Luca went too long.
That's okay.
Yeah, thank you, Mattia. We are looking for it in the sense that we still not applied the strategy to the bidirectional coupling, but we are extending the work also in this direction. So it will be one of the next steps.
Thank you.
Okay, so maybe Mattia, you do have time for a second question, sorry.
The second one was if you can demonstrate also usefulness for the noise rejection, because if there is noise in the channel, it probably you can have a benefit from using a filtering effect as you did actually using dynamic coupling.
Yeah, you are right. There are some studies about this problem, and so dynamic coupling in general can introduce also this kind of advantage. We will not take care about this in these works, but it is already part of the literature about this further enhancement in terms of noise rejection in case of dynamic coupling. So it's another point that we can stress about this methodology.
Thank you.
Okay, very good. So thank you very much.
You're welcome.
And actually, maybe the next speaker is Mattia. Is that correct, Mattia? Or
Yeah.
So wonderful. So Mattia, you can share your screen. And so Mattia is gonna present his paper on synchronization in oscillators coupled via hubs attracting Laplacians. So once again, Mattia, I will give you a warning after 15 minutes.
That's fine. Thank you.
Thank you.
So this is a joint work with Lucia Valentina Gambuzza from the same university, University of Catania, to which I belong, and Ernesto Estrada, which is now professor at the Universidad of de Zaragoza, Spain. So let me start with an outline. I would like to start with some motivation for this work. Then I will like to present you this new Laplacian matrix that we called hubs attracting. And then we will go actually quite quickly through the theoretical result which regards the spectrum of this matrix. Then I will show you some computational result we derived. And finally, I will show you an example where we applied this Laplacian essentially in the study of synchronization in phase oscillator, or to be more precise for the formation control of unicycles. And finally, I will conclude with some final consideration. So let me start with the motivation. There are actually many ideas in which you can extend the classical Laplacian operator to include features that are not considered in the classical case. The Laplacian operator is very important because it is useful in modeling many dynamical processes which are described in networks, and the interaction actually are captured by Laplacian matrices. But the classical Laplacian actually describes a scenario where all the weights are equal. So essentially there is no difference in the kind of interaction that two agents may have. So thinking about diffusion particles, when we study diffusion ruled by the classical Laplacian, then we have unbiased diffusion. So this means that if we have a particle in a network node, then it is going to go with equal probability to any of its neighbors. But you can think to other diffusion processes. And for instance, you can think to a diffusion process which is biased in the sense that each particle can have a preferred direction, and its preferred direction may be going towards nodes which have a high degree, so an high number of neighbors, or on the opposite, keeping far from these nodes. This was actually the idea that Ernesto explored, define the hubs repelling Laplacian. So Laplacian matrix, which is able to capture diffusion of particles, which move away from hubs. And you find in the slide a reference for his beautiful work on linear algebra and its application. Here, along with Tim, we explored the opposite case, the opposite scenario. So where the preferred direction is to go towards high degree nodes. And we moved away from the study of diffusion diffusion particles, but then we concentrated on synchronization, because we can demonstrate that actually this idea of the hubs attracting Laplacian is useful for synchronization. And in this sense, our work reconnects with other works which, starting from the classical Laplacian connectivity, try to enhance the synchronizability of a network by rewiring or assigning different weights to the links existing in a network. So here, essentially, in some sense, we are following this path and giving a different routes for how to change the weights, still taking into account the existing topology. So the goal of this work is essentially to introduce the hubs attracting Laplacian and to show some of these properties, and finally to apply to synchronization in networks where we have where we are going to use this Laplacian to model the connectivity. So let me first explore this last, because it actually motivates our work. So question one, it's a general question for coupled oscillators, where you have probably seen several times a very similar formula, where you have L, the classical Laplacian ruling the interaction. Here, the only difference we have is to replace the classical Laplacian with this hubs attracting Laplacian that still not yet defined, but this is essentially the framework in which we want to move. Synchronization, with this term, we means the fully synchronization. So we are looking for the condition where all the possible pairs of nodes are with some norm asymptotically going to zero. You can measure for a network the synchronizability with two different parameters. They apply to different cases depending on the unit's dynamics, on the way these units are coupling, etc. But both have an important characteristic. Both are information that we can derive from the Laplacian. And the first important result of our work is that you can generalize this synchronizability measure. So as for the classical Laplacian case, you can use the spectral gap and the Eigen ratio Q. Then for networks like in equation one, you can follow the same approach. If you replace the first non-zero eigenvalue of the Laplacian with the first non-zero eigenvalue of the hubs attracting Laplacian. This is possible by an important property of the hubs attracting Laplacian, which is the fact that it is a positive semi-definite matrix. So all its eigenvalues are actually real. This is even if the matrix is weighted. Okay, so this is the reason essentially why we study the hubs attracting, and in particular the spectral properties. Okay, let's now go to some formal step. So let's start from the definition. The hubs attracting Laplacian is an operator defined on a connected graph. You see the formula. Essentially, the big difference is the introduction of this ratio, Kw divided by Kv, which where Kw and Kv are the degree, so the node degree of node W and node V. So essentially, we are weighting the connection by taking into account both the degree of the receiving and the sending node. Then you can find some useful formulas that we have used actually in our proof. So essentially you can rewrite the abstract tracking Laplacian in terms of the degree matrix and the adjacency matrix. Okay, the counterpart is the abstract repelling Laplacian that, as I said, was studied by Ernest in his work, where you do the opposite, in the sense that you simply take the inverse of the ratio that we have discussed so far. Okay, let's now go to the main properties of the apps attracting Laplacian. Clearly, this is an oral presentation, then it is also online, so let me skip everything which is a proof. I'm just going to the main properties. So this matrix is positive semi-definite, its eigenvalues are real, the rank is given by n, which is the size of the network minus the number of connected components, and et cetera, et cetera. You can also diagonalize the matrix. So essentially, you find really that this abstract tracking Laplacian is really a generalization of the classical Laplacian, because you preserve the very important properties that allow the application to synchronization. So let me now move to the lemma. If the graph is k-regular, then the abstract tracking Laplacian, actually also the abstract repelling Laplacian, they become or equal to the classical Laplacian, and so there is no difference clearly, because the degree of each node is the same. Okay, so let me call the eigenvalues as mu a1, et cetera, et cetera. We can order them. The first is always zero. And let me show some theoretical result and computational result. For the theoretical result, essentially, we derive the bounds for all the quantities of interest. So the spectral gap, the largest eigenvalue, and the ratio QA. And in terms of computational result, we studied both small graph and large graph. So as I am a little bit slower than what I was expecting, let me go even quicker than this theoretical result. Essentially, we have derived the bounds, and you can find formulas for mu a n, for mu a q, and for qa as well. But let me concentrate a little bit more on the computational result, maybe because they are more interesting to discuss. So what I'm showing here are the computation essentially for mu 2, so for the spectral gap of the Laplacian, of the classical Laplacian, of the abstracting Laplacian, and I'm also showing the theoretical bound. And this analysis is done for all connected graph with sides ranging from 2 to 10, from 3 to 10. So essentially, we are studying all the possible graphs. So we are, this is a systematic analysis. So at the end, we have studied something like 12 million of graph. You can do this because clearly the computation are quite easy. What kind of information we derive? First of all, that the bounds are okay. The bounds are the orange lines, and they stay all above the black curve, which is actually the result on the abstract tracking Laplacian. But more interesting, what you find is that the synchronizability measure, and this applies for mu2 as well as for q, the synchronizability measure is always higher than in the classical Laplacian. So you have some improvement in the synchronization. because this is what the computation are doing. I say always, but actually this is not exactly true, because we have found example where this condition is violated. And in particular, this table summarizes the result. So you see that the percentage where there is no improvement is around, is less than 1% for graphs having 6 nodes, and then it decreases for nodes having 7, 8, and so on. So actually, this is one interesting open question which arises from this work, and is what special features have these graphs? Actually, we were not able to answer. We have found some property which is actually not sufficient to explain this difference. So for instance, they have minimum degree greater than or equal to 2. But it's a puzzling question that we would like to solve. And it's interesting to note that the occurrence of these odd cases where you have no improvement decrease with n. And in particular, if we move now to the study of large random graph like classic Erdos-Reni network and Barabasi-Albert network, you find no occurrence of this. So in this network, practically, you have always improvement in using the apps attracting Laplacian. Since the time is going to finish, let me simply spend some insight we had on why the Laplacian, this Laplacian may be useful for synchronization. And this is actually because the apps are playing an important role. And with this Laplacian, you actually favor this role. So the apps are a center for disseminating the information needed for synchronization. Here, using the apps attracting Laplacian, then you improve this capability of the apps. And in fact, you see that the
But here you are at 15 minutes 30.
Yeah. I'm going to conclude. And actually, you see that the larger improvement occurs in Barabasi-Albert network, where there are more apps. Let me just show the last slide. We have applied this to synchronization phase oscillator, which is a framework for studying, for instance, formation control of unicycles. And you can see that in the first panel that there is actually an advantage also in the time for synchronization. That's all. This is simply a summary, so I can stop here and leave the slide for the audience to read.
Great, thanks a lot. Do we have any questions? Yes, go ahead.
Okay, I was just wondering.
Mauro,
yes,
is that right?
Yes, I'm Mauro.
Mauro, okay.
I was just wondering, in this definition of hubs attracting Laplacian, is if I take the same graph, so if I take a graph, the diameter computed according to the weights of the hubs attracting Laplacian, is it always less than the weighted diameter computed according to a standard Laplacian?
I think so, yeah, I think so. Even if okay. I don't remember exactly the calculation we've done for this, but I think so. I think your intuition is correct.
Okay, so probably this is attracting Laplacian have a property that the longest among the shortest paths between any two nodes are smaller, and so that helps.
That helps synchronization. It's another reason for which synchronization may be yeah.
Okay, thank you.
Okay. Any other question? So Mattia, maybe I can ask you one thing. So you have this non-synchronizing situations, but these Laplacians are for undirected graphs. Is that correct?
Yeah, yeah.
So what is the, because like for a standard interconnection, say of integrators, you would have that a full, like a fully connected graph would give you the property, like second eigenvalue of the Laplacian being positive would always give you synchronization. So it was just, I didn't fully understand what are the non-synchronizing cases.
Yeah, 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 okay. No, probably I was not sufficiently clear. The improvement in synchronization in this case means that you can synchronize with a smaller coupling gain.
Okay.
So we are not talking about networks that were not synchronized and then we are, they are synchronized after the application of this Laplacian. We are comparing two networks that both synchronize. And then in the case of chaotic oscillator, for instance, you are able to do with smaller gain. In the case of integrators, which is essentially the case I've shown before of unicycles, the benefit that you have in having, it's essentially that you reduce the time to synchronization because you improve mu2.
Okay, thanks a lot. Thanks a lot, and thanks for the presentation.
Thank you.
So we can move on to the next speaker. We are 30 seconds late. Oh, that's bad. I feel so much pressure. Okay, so the next speech is probably given by Enrica Rossi. Is that correct?
Yeah, Enrica? Yeah, yeah. Thank you.
And Enrica will talk about cooperative trajectory tracking over sampled communication.
Okay.
Please, Enrica, go ahead and share your screen.
Yeah, I would like to switch on the video, but it tells me that I cannot because the host has stopped it, but I can share the presentation anyway.
Well, I think you can share the presentation and that's going to be okay, right?
Okay, maybe.
And then try again now.
We can see your video too. We can see your video.
Perfect. Okay, I can try with the full screen and then you tell me if you see it.
It works.
Okay.
Perfect. Thank you.
Okay, so I can start.
Yes.
Okay, thank you for the introduction, Luca. Today I will talk about cooperative trajectory tracking over sample communication. This is a work that I developed during my PhD with my professor Luca Schenato, and it's a collaboration between LAS CNRS, that is a laboratory in Toulouse, France, and the University of Padova. So first of all, we are interested into AMANDA aerial vehicles, because they are, there are a lot of scenarios where they are used, such as surveillance explorations, both civil and military environments and so on. Moreover, we are interested in using group of robots instead of a single one, because in this way we can improve the task performance, such as a limit sensor range that can be expanded using multiple robots. But also if you think about transporting an object, of course it's easier with a group of robots. And usually to control these systems, you can use a centralized strategy where the controller knows the whole state of the system. But we know that if the central unit fails, then the whole task fails. In this case, the design of the controller is like simpler with respect to a decentralized scenario where we don't have global information, but on the other hand, we can guarantee major robustness and flexibility. But in this case, the design of the controller is more difficult. So the goal is to make a group of robots to perform a common task. In particular, we in some way we want to use communication, and the motivation was given by the scenario on the left, where you can see a group of robots, ground robots, which transport an object via some rigid connections. In this way, force feedback allows to compute exactly the pose, position, and orientation of the object. So in this case, no communication is needed among the robots. But what happens when we use a cable suspended-based solution? So in this case, for instance, there are three aerial vehicles which transport a platform. In this this case, we use, for example, some cables, and we know that the exact pose, position, and orientation of the object cannot be retrieved exactly using force feedback. So in this case, communication is needed. But we are interested in particular into wireless communication, where there are no cables which can disturb the dynamics of the system, and we know that wireless has a lot of advantages, but also it's unreliable because signals are sampled, they arrive at sampling instance, and also that the reception is asynchronous. In particular, we simplify a wireless connection with sample measurements. So we assume that the measurements from the platform, for example, its pose, arrives with a certain frequency between 1 and 100 hertz. So the contribution is the design of a sampled communication-aware inverse kinematic controller for multi-robot system. This means that we consider a multi-robot system that is sampled communication-aware because measurements arrive at sampling instance, as we just said, and the controller is inverse kinematic based. In particular, we want to make this multi-robot system track a desired trajectory, a set of configurations and velocities. We propose two different strategies to compute the gain of our controller. In particular, for the first strategy, we can prove stability of the system during the tracking operation and zero tracking error. As far as the second strategy is concerned, we will see that a faster convergence rate can be achieved, but we provide only practical results. And then we show via some simulations the result of a system like the one that I just described, where there are three aerial vehicles that transport the object. So the scenario is the following one, where we have a certain number n of robots, one pivot that is a point that can be the platform that is transported in this scenario, but also a robot to be escorted or a general point in the space. In particular, QI are the configurations of the robots with respect to the pivot. In this case, they are the angles of the cables. In this case, instead, they are the angles of the robots with respect to a fixed reference frame. And then QV is the pose of the pivot, that is position orientation. Finally, in Q and P, we collect the Lagrangian coordinates and the position of the robots. What we propose is a multi-layer architecture where we assume that there is a global planner that generates offline the desired trajectory for our system to be tracked. Then our controller receives the desired configuration velocities and the measurement from the system, and kinematically based, it generates the desired velocities for the vehicles. And then we assume that each vehicle, each robot, is endowed with a low-level velocity controller that works at a faster frequency and is able to implement at each instant the desired velocity sent by our controller. So to design our controller, we needed to derive the kinematic model, that is this one, where we have the Lagrangian variables Q and the position of the robots. And you can observe that the position of each robot depends only on its configuration with respect to the pivot and on the pivot configuration. It does not depend on the other robot's configuration. As a consequence, when you derive the differential kinematics, the Jacobian matrix that links the velocity of the Lagrangian variables and the velocities of the robots has zero values outside the main diagonal. In this case, we assume that the Jacobian matrix is a square and full rank, even if we developed some work even when it's not square matrix. So, recalling the structure that I just presented, we need to derive the inverse kinematic of the system. So, from this equation, we can obtain this one. And we already said that we generate the desired velocities for the robots. So, we design this control law U that will be substituted in this equation. And after that, we can see the dynamics of the system. In particular, we define this control law in the following way, where we have a term that is feedback based and depends on a gain K that we'll design and on the received measurements, and then a feed forward term. In particular, if we think that measurements are continuously available, for example, so in this case, instead of having the wireless symbol, we have a cable, for example, that sends the measurements to the controller. In this case, it's easy to show that if we choose the controller in this way and we substitute it into the inverse kinematics, like I just described, where the control law is made up of the feedback term that is like this one, where we have the current and desired configuration, the Jacobian matrix, and then the feedforward term with the Jacobian and the desired velocity, then we can show that the tracking error goes to zero exponentially fast. We only need to choose a positive gain k. Then we are interested to know what happens when measurements are sampled, that is when we use a wireless connection. So in this case, we propose we analyze three different strategies. The first one is a point stabilization, that is, we don't use the feedforward term, and we try to use only the feedback part. So it depends only on the last received measurement at time h of t, where t is the sampling time. In this case, we can show that the tracking error is bounded, but we cannot prove convergence to zero. As a consequence, we need a feedforward term. So a second possible solution is the sampling of the continuous time law that I introduced before, where we have the feedback-based part that depends on the last measurement that we received, the controller received. And then there is this feedforward term where you have the Jacobian that is computed on the last received measurements, while we assume that the desired values are always available because we recall that they are generated by the global planner. So we assume that they are always available. Even in this case, if we start with zero error, we can show that it's not possible to guarantee that perfect tracking is kept along the trajectory. So we propose a way to slightly change this term in this way. Instead of computing the Jacobian on the last received measurement, we compute it on the desired value. And we know that this is continuously available. Moreover, we propose two different strategies to compute the gain of the feedback term. As far as the first strategy, as I said in the introduction, is concerned, we can prove stability and convergence of the error to zero. Instead, for the second strategies, we show only practical results in simulations. In particular, for the offline strategies to compute the offline gain, we could show that there are different regions. In particular, if we pick a couple of gain and sampling time in the red regions, we can show that the system is not stable in this case. We also show that there exists a green region where if we pick K and T into this area, then we can show that the stability is guaranteed, where stability is considered as the fact that the error, the norm of the tracking error decreases between two different sampling sampling times with a certain convergence rate. Actually, we showed exponential convergence in this case. Moreover, we showed also that there exists a minimum gain that we can use depending on the sampling period, and there exist two lines, the blue and yellow one, which guarantees the faster convergence rate. This means that if we fixed the gain of our controller, then we can pick the sampling time on the related line in order to have the faster convergence rate. On the other hand, if we fixed the other variable, the sampling time, then we can obtain the optimal gain to obtain a faster convergence rate. As far as the online strategy, instead, this is only an idea. We exploited an auxiliary system that evolves from the current configuration, this is the last received measurements, until a certain point. This point has been studied to be the time where the solution of this auxiliary system is closest to the desired configuration. At any time, we can retrieve the solution of the original system. And this choice of this time to stop the evolution of the auxiliary system allows to define the gain in the online scenario. This means that for each configuration the system is, then we can compute the time where the solution of the auxiliary system is closest to the desired values, and then we obtain in this, with this formulation, the gain of the online case. This is the result when we apply the four different strategies. In particular, we took the system that I described before with the aerial vehicles and the object that is transported via some cables. We know that when we apply the point stabilization strategies, that is the one without the feedforward term, we have the biggest error. In this case, this is the norm of the error of the Lagrangian variables. Then you can see that there is a little improvement where we use the sampling of the continuous time law, that was the second proposed solution. But still there is an error. The two strategies that we propose that I mentioned before are 1 and 2, where you can see that the error is the smallest one among all the four strategies. And also strategy number one guarantees a sort of a quicker convergence to zero of the error. So we have shown that in theory that strategy 2 can guarantee stability and convergence to zero of the error. But we also see through simulation that even when we compute online the gain of our controller, we can guarantee the error to be close to zero. So in conclusion, what we proposed was a controller to make a multi-robot system track a desired trajectory. We are interested in the case where there is no communication among the robots, but only a central unit can send information. In our case, it was the position and orientation of the object. And we also developed a multi-layer structure where there is the global planner that generates the desired trajectory and our controller that generates the desired robot's velocities in presence of a sampled measurement. So we are able to guarantee that the system keeps stable during the trajectory tracking operation, even in presence of a sample measurement. And we proposed two different strategies to compute the controller gain. So this is it. Thank you for your attention. So if you have any question, I answer it.
Thank you very much, Enrica.
Thank you.
So do we have any questions from the audience?
Sorry for the noise before, but there were my cats.
No worries. Erika, I have a question for you. So in your simulations, you had some noise, right? I was curious to understand where it is introduced and how you modeled it.
Yeah, this simulation was performed with a model that was developed in Gazebo at LAS CNRS. So it considers the noise of the motors of the robots, of the GPS measurements, also of the measurements coming from the cameras that observe and track the object. So there, it's a sum of different noises that comes from a realistic simulation where there is the dynamical model. And
so you run a simulation that essentially has, you know, mismatch, you know, with respect to the design model, which is more, you know, equation based.
Yeah,
I see.
Okay. Yeah. And actually this is a result of different simulation. For example, for each strategy, I performed different simulations and I computed the mean error to have a more complete solution.
I see, thank you.
Thank you.
Any other questions? Okay, so then maybe I will ask another question. So it's a very interesting result, by the way. I would like to ask, you used the periodic sampling, right? So your capital T. Have you considered using non-periodic sampling, you know, event triggered, you know, that might provide some advance.
Yeah.
But of course, the implementation might be hard.
Yeah, we only tried, instead of the dynamic model with Gazebo that is very realistic, we tried with a dynamical model made of equations in Simulink, and we used TrueTime, I don't know if you know it, it's a simulation environment to simulate a wireless network, so with not only sampling time, but asynchronous measurements and also packet losses. And I have some results where I can see that the system still converges to the desired configuration.
Yeah, I see. But I meant even in the design, you know, like you can use event-triggered or self-triggered control. And I was wondering whether it could give you better results in terms of, you know, like I don't see if you see any potential in extending your technique.
Actually, this is a possible extension because we started to analyze it in the beginning, then we developed with this technique, but I think that it's an interesting extension of this work and more realistic one. So okay. It's a good
Thank
point.
You.
Thank you.
Thank you. Okay. So I think we can move on to the next speaker. So this would be probably Zore Sanai. I hope I didn't misspell your name. Okay, I would ask you to unmute your microphone because it's muted.
Yes.
Perfect.
Is it okay?
We can hear you.
Perfect. Okay.
Thank you. So I think you can share your screen.
Sure.
So that you can start the presentation. And Zore Sanai will present her work on dynamic consensus on the median value in open multi-agent systems. Please go ahead.
Okay. Thank you. I'm Zore Sanai, who is working under the supervision of Professor Carlo Sietzo and Dr. Mauro Franceschelli. This talk provides an overview of our recent activity about dynamic consensus on the median value in open multi-agent systems. This presentation is organized as follows. Let us talk about an introduction to multi-agent systems. A multi-agent system is a set of dynamical agents, such as multi-robot systems, sensor networks, power grids, and so on, that interact with each other with a pattern distributed by a graph, where the coupling may consist of sensing, communication, and so forth, depending on the application. The communication topology among the agents is modeled as a connected time-varying undirected graph, where G of T is our graph, the time-varying undirected graph, and V of T is denoted as the time-varying set of agents. E of T is the time-varying set of edges. The cardinality of V of T is equal to the number of agents, and Ni of T is denoted as the set of neighbors of agent I. One of the issues which is still open in tracking the value of external signals is how to deal in the case where agents log in and log out. Here we mention some references who worked on different scenarios where in the multi-agent systems, agent can join or leave the network according to the models proposed by the authors. Consensus can be defined as a control objective where all the agents in a network converge to a common value. In the average consensus, the desired value is the average of set of constants. When the desired value is the median of a set of constants, the problem is denoted as consensus on the median value. This problem has been investigated in reference 5. When the desired value is the median of a set of time-varying inputs, the problem is denoted as dynamic consensus on the median value problem. Although there are a lot of people who worked on dynamic consensus, there is only this paper who worked on dynamic consensus on the median value of a set of time-varying reference signals. Here we present the main contributions of reference 8 that extend the result of reference 5 by considering a dynamic consensus on the median value problem in the framework of open multi-agent systems. Thus, both reference signals given to the agents and the composition of the network is time varying as opposed to time invariant. Let us move over to section 2. This is the protocol that is considered in this work. It is worth mentioning that in reference 5, the authors consider UAI as a constant input, whereas here UAI is considered as a time-varying input. The median value of a set of real numbers is a number which is greater than half of the numbers in a set and smaller than the other half. Let us consider these equations. If the number of agents is odd, then set the solution of set G of D is a singleton, so the median value is unique. On the other hand, if the number of agents is even, then set G of D contains two solutions. By averaging the solutions of set G of D, we can obtain the median value. We also define the so-called median interval. Any number inside this interval is considered as a median value. We also defined LM of T as the length of the median interval. Clearly, LM of T is equal to zero when the number of agents is odd. To clarify the definitions, we provide two examples. In the first example, the number of agents is considered equal to 5 with these reference signals. From the left equation, the solution of set G of D can be obtained equal to 6. So from the right equation, the median value can be obtained equal to 6. Furthermore, median interval and the length of the median interval from their definitions can be obtained equal to 6 and 0 respectively. In the second example, the number of agents is considered equal to 6 with these reference signals. The solution of set G of D is equal to 6 and 7. By averaging the elements of set G of D, we can obtain the median value equal to 6.5. Furthermore, the median interval and the length of the median interval from their definitions can be obtained equal to this and this. Here we mention the assumptions that we use in this work. It is considered that graph G is undirected and connected for all times greater than or equal to zero, and the set of instances of time in which graph G changes is of measure zero. It is assumed that there exists a minimum dual time delta tau separating two consecutive instances in which agents join or leave the network. It is considered that NMX belongs to the open interval of zero and infinity such that the number of agents is less than or equal to NMX. It is supposed that all reference signals have bounded derivative. If this assumption holds, then it is proved that the derivative of the median value is less than or equal to pi. And finally, it is assumed that maximum reference signals minus minimum reference signals is less than or equal to capital B. Let us shift to section 3. Now we want to show that the states of agents track the median value of time-varying reference signals in finite time. To this aim, we first show in theorem 1, the states of agents reach C of D in finite time. Then in theorem 2, we indicate the states of agents track the median value of time-varying reference signals in finite time. Theorem one, consider a time-varying undirected connected graph satisfying assumption one. Agents may join or leave the network according to assumptions two and three. If alpha and lambda be in this range, then the states of agents reach C of T in finite time capital T. Let us prove this claim. Consider Lyapunov function V1 equal to this. Then by a smooth analysis, it can be shown that the derivative of the Lyapunov function is negative if alpha and lambda be in this range. Now we characterize the convergence properties in the open scenario. It is shown in this paper when an agent joins to the network at time t plus with this initial value, or if an agent leaves the network at time t plus, resulting that the Lyapunov function at time t plus is less than or equal to the Lyapunov function at time t. Therefore, the derivative of the Lyapunov function at time t plus is negative if alpha and lambda be in this range. By using this inequality, the maximum finite convergence time, capital T1, can be obtained as follows. Theorem two, consider a time-varying undirected and connected graph satisfying assumption. If alpha and lambda be in this range under assumption four, and let the consensus condition, the states of agents, be equal to the time-varying consensus function, be in force starting from time capital T, then the time-varying consensus function belongs to the median interval in finite time capital T2. Let us prove this claim. Consider Lyapunov function V2 equal to this. The time derivative of the Lyapunov function can be obtained as follows. Let's compute the convergence time by using this inequality. By letting Lyapunov function at time capital T2 less than or equal to Lm of capital T2, in which Lm of t is the length of the median interval. And as we mentioned before, Lm of t is equal to zero when the number of agents is odd. Then the convergence time, capital T2, can be obtained as follows. You can find more details about this proof in the mentioned paper. Now we want to show that the states of agents track the median value of time-varying reference signals in finite time with bounded error when an agent join or leave the network. Consider a time-varying undirected and connected graph satisfying assumption one. Assume that agents join or leave the network according to assumptions two and three. If alpha and lambda be in this range under assumption three, and let the consensus condition that agents be equal to the time-varying consensus function be in force starting from time capital T, maximum reference signals minus minimum reference signals is less than or equal to capital B, then the states of agents track the median value of time-varying reference signals in finite time capital T with bounded error. Let us prove this claim. Consider two instances of time, T prime and T second. There exists at most one agent that join or leave the network at T hat belongs to this interval. The variation of the Lyapunov function at time T hat yields this inequality. Let's compute the convergence time by using this inequality. if t prime is equal to capital T as the initial instant of time, then there exists k belongs to the positive n, such that the Lyapunov function can be obtained as follows. If capital B is less than or equal to this, then the convergence time can be obtained as follows. Section 4, numerical simulations. In this section, we provide two numerical tests. In the first test, we consider the number of edges equal to 5. The tuning parameters are chosen according to the theorems, and the initial states of the agents are selected uniformly at random from this interval. The reference signals are considered equal to this. In the left figure, you can see the time varying reference signals and their median value. In the left figure, it is obvious that the states of agents track the median value of time varying reference signals in finite time with zero error. In the second test, we consider the number of agents equal to 9 with this scenario. In this test, we consider an open scenario where the agents may join or leave the network. The figures show that the median value changes when an agent joins or leaves the network. In the right figure, it is clear that the states of agents remain at consensus with a bounded distance from the median value during the join and leave events. Finally, conclusions. It is proved that the states of agents track with zero error in finite time the median value of a set of time-varying reference signals with bounded variations. Furthermore, it is shown that when agents join and leave the network with an appropriate dwell time, the consensus value tracks with bounded error the median value. Future works will investigate discrete time versions of the proposed approach and its resilience with respect to false or malicious agents. Thank you for your attention.
Okay, thank you very much for the presentation. Do we have any questions from the audience? Yes, Diego, go ahead.
Hi, Zora.
Hi.
So I have a question. Are you assuming that there is a dwell time between the joining event, right, or leaving event?
Yes.
So have you any assumption on the, like, a lower bound to the dwell time, or it must just be not zero?
We consider that between each agent that wants to join or leave the network, there should be at least delta tau time. It means that there should be this distance.
Okay, so actually, I think you are considering the leaving or joining event of just one agent each time.
Exactly.
Not two or three at the same time, right?
Exactly. It should be a distance between them for join and leaving. Yes.
Okay, perfect. Thank you for the clarification.
You're welcome.
Other questions? Okay, so maybe I'll ask a question, Zore. In your Lyapunov analysis, I think I saw in your slides that actually the Lyapunov function always decreases when the agents come and go. Is that correct? Or because I'm surprised that an agent that comes in doesn't cause a growth of the Lyapunov function.
When an agent joins or leaves, it causes in an instant time the Lyapunov function increase, but it's with a bounded error because we assume that the maximum reference signals minus minimum reference signals is less than or equal to B. So it's bounded. Because it's bounded, it's okay for us.
So how do you solve this increase? Is there a mechanism for ensuring that then after that it will decrease again for a long enough time? What is the core idea behind tolerating this increase, which is probably inevitable, right?
Actually, when an agent joins to the network, the Lyapunov function doesn't change because we consider that it joins with the initial value equal to the average of its neighbors. So if it joins with the maximum value of its neighbors or with the minimum value, because we consider our Lyapunov function such that we can handle it and it's okay in that situation, so it doesn't change. But when an agent leaves, it causes a decrease in the Lyapunov function, because if, for example, the agent that leaves has the maximum value, so our Lyapunov function decreases. That's why when an agent joins or leaves at time, for example, T plus, it's less than or equal to our previous Lyapunov function.
Okay, I see. I didn't understand this fact. That's an important fact, that the initial condition of the joining agents is fixed and it's equal to the average. Okay, now that makes a lot of sense. Okay, thanks a lot. Okay, so I think we can move on to our last talk of the session, which is probably gonna be given by Diego De Plano. Is that correct, Diego?
Yes.
Okay, so I will ask you to, Zora to stop sharing and Diego to start.
Yes, sure, sharing. Now I will do it.
Okay, and Diego will talk about discrete time dynamic consensus on the max value.
Yes, so I can start.
Otherwise, we ask for the help of. Okay, very good.
Okay, I can put it in full screen.
Yes.
Okay.
So, perfect. Perfect. So, we can see well. Go ahead, Diego.
Thank you for the introduction. So, hello, everybody. I'm a PhD student at the University of Cagliari under the supervision of Professor Giua and Franceschelli. Today, I'm going to present our work with title Discrete Time Dynamic Consensus on the Max Value. And the outline of my presentation is quite standard. So first of all, I will set up the problem. We consider a network of agents modeled as autonomous discrete time dynamical systems with scalar state Xi. The agents interact according to a communication network, which can be represented by a graph, and we consider it undirected. So each agent has access to the state of its neighbors and also to an external input reference signal, UI, which is also scalar, and evolves according to a state transition function as in equation one. We call the map Fi the local interaction rule. So the goal of the agent is to auto-organize in order to compute a function of the external input in a distributed fashion, meaning that each agent has not access to the other inputs, but only to the states of its neighbors and the state itself of the same agent. So when these inputs are constants over time, the strategy usually employed is to initialize the multi-agent system to the constant input, and then design a local protocol in order to steer the system to a function of the initial states. The literature has mainly focused on the average estimation, where the problem is to estimate the average of the initial states. However, the average is not always the most useful value. As we have seen in the previous situation, in the previous presentation, other quantity may be of interest. For example, the median value. In this work, we are considering the maximum value. So in particular, Cortes was one of the first to address the problem in a continuous time framework, providing a nonlinear protocol to solve the problem in the static case. In the two works of Neihad, the standard max consensus protocol is analyzed and characterized for fixed and switching topologies. Later, asynchronicity and noise in the communication channel were studied respectively by Utzler and Zhang,
And finally, Abderrahim investigated the case of open multi-agent systems, where the agents may leave or join the network. When the inputs vary over time, also the function to be estimated does. So in this case, the strategy of initializing the network and then run a static algorithm does not work anymore. On the contrary, one needs a dynamic protocol, meaning that this, starting from any initial condition, it still must be able to track the function, which is time varying. When the function to be estimated is the maximum, up to our knowledge, there are not existing results in the literature. This is the main motivation underneath our research. So our main contribution is to provide a first protocol able to solve this problem up to a bounded error, epsilon, for which we derived an upper bound, a strict upper bound, for both static and dynamic inputs. Applications of the max consensus algorithm mainly reside in the field of distributed estimation and network parameter estimation. In the work of Deng Chang, the max consensus protocol was exploited to compensate for clock drift effects among the clocks with different clock rate. Lucchese analyzed how aggregation-based estimators for cardinality estimation purposes are accurate when the aggregation function is the maximum. And also max consensus can be exploited in order to elect a leader in the network. In particular, the work of Borsch highlighted a strong correlation between D2D centrality as an election method and the cost of achieving an assigned task. So in this slide, we can see the proposed protocol. The only input parameter is the parameter alpha, which is required to be a positive number, strictly positive number, while it's not required any specific initialization of the state variables of the multi-agent system. After the initialization step, which can be completely distributed, at subsequent steps, the agents collect the state information of their neighbors and update their state according to the local interaction rule in equation 2. The updating rule is quite intuitive. Each agent takes as next state the maximum among its own input and the state of its neighbors reduced by a parameter alpha and its own input. The key idea of the protocol is the introduction of this parameter alpha. In fact, it avoids the agent to remain stuck at the same value while force them to reduce the maximum among all the agents until the maximum among all the input reference signals is, let me say, reached. To clarify this functioning, I will show you a simple yet illustrative example. So we consider a network of three nodes in a line configuration. For the first 30 steps, the input reference signals remain constant and equal to 1, 2, and 3, respectively, as it is shown in the figure in the bottom left, while the system is initialized in the interval 0, 5. It can be noticed in the top left figure that first all the agents reach a consensus value, which is greater than the maximum value among the inputs, which is 3. And then all the states of the agents start decreasing monotonically altogether until the maximum 3 is reached. And then they reach this stable configuration. So node 1, which has the maximum input, reaches exactly the maximum, while all the others starts assuming a steady condition, which is with a distance which is proportional to the shortest distance to the node with the maximum input. On the left, on the right, we can see other time for this simulation, and we can see that when the maximum among the inputs starts varying, so first decreases and then increases, the agents are able to track this value. The main assumption we make in this work is that the absolute variation of the input reference signals must be bounded by a positive constant pi. I want to highlight that this is a reasonable assumption, since any continuous time signal with bounded derivative can be oversampled to reduce its absolute variation. And also the signals may be positive or negative or go around zero without any problem. So the only assumption is the boundedness of the derivative and the variation if it's quantized. So this is our main result. And I'm going to not to read it, but to give you which is the main contribution. So the only two conditions required by the theorem are, first of all, that the graph must be connected. The graph is static and must be connected. And then the second condition is that the parameter alpha of the algorithm must be strictly greater than pi, which is the variation of the bounded variation of the inputs. So under these conditions, we claim that there exists a finite time t, upper bounded by equation 3, after which the absolute value of each agent in estimating the maximum value among the reference signals is upper bounded by a constant epsilon tr, as in equation 4, whose value is given in equation 5. It is important to notice that the bound on the absolute error epsilon tr depends only on the characteristics of the network through the diameter and not the number of the agents in the multi-agent system in the network, on the input reference signals, and on the parameter of the protocol alpha. We now proceed with a sketch of the proof of our main result. So each tracking error of the agents are obviously upper bounded by epsilon. Actually, this is a typo. So this is an E of K. So E of K denotes the maximum error among all the inputs, among all the agents, and can be reformulated as in equation 6, where X bar and X under bar are defined in equation 7. So for the moment, we are going to take as true, but we are going to prove it in the following two slides, that the upper bound to the maximum among all the input state is as in equation 8, and a lower bound to the minimum among all the agent states are as in equation 9. So by exploiting equation 8 and 9 and substituting them in equation 6, we can obtain the upper bound as in equation 10. So actually, I think I'm a bit running out of time for all my presentations, so I will skip the proof of the equation 8 and 9. For the details, I will refer at the end of the presentation to our work on archive. And I will go directly to the corollary. So when the input reference signals are not time varying but are constant, it means that their variation is actually zero. So we can just substitute pi equal to zero to derive stricter condition on the upper bound of the convergence time and the error tracking. Okay, now some simulations. So in the following, we show some simulation in order to corroborate the theoretical results. In our first simulation, we decided to use a network of 6 nodes in a line graph as interconnection topology. The line graph is the worst case for our protocol, since it maximizes the diameter of the network with the same number of nodes. This first example is a in this first example, the maximum value to be tracked is constant. And as we can see, at the beginning, the error starts decreasing monotonically until a region of attraction is reached. And in the steady state, the error among all the estimations of the agents is exactly the bound that we have proved in our corollary. For time varying inputs, we can see that during the tracking, we see that from more or less 70 to 150, the inputs is varying at its maximum rate. And in this period, the error tracking is actually not so much, because when the maximum is decreasing, we have the less error, while when the maximum among all the inputs is going up, so it's increasing, we have the maximum error, which is exactly the bound we have computed in our theorem. So another example is a sinusoid, which is an example of the fact that our protocol can deal with positive and negative inputs. And I want to use this example to show you how the choice of alpha can affect both the time convergence and the error convergence. So in this case, the rate of change, the variation of the maximum is pi equals 0.2, and we have chosen alpha 0.21. What happens if we increase the value of alpha to, let's say, 0.51? Well, we can see that the convergence time now is shorter. So from more or less 100, we have here less than 50. But at the same time, the error from 0.225 increases to 0.375. So actually alpha, the choice of alpha, trades off convergence time and the error. Finally, we wanted to show also an example on a large network of 10,000 nodes where the inputs vary randomly. And we can see that also in this scenario, the error decreases monotonically till the region of attraction is reached. And from that moment, the error is always below the bound provided by the theorem. So I will skip the conclusion that it's actually just a summary of what I've said in the last 15 minutes. And I want to focus one more minute on our work in progress, actually not future works, but it's something that we have already done. So and this is the main motivation of this research, which is the application of this dynamic consensus on the max value to the size or cardinality estimation of anonymous multi-agent networks. So we have understood also from the previous presentation that an open multi-agent system is a system where the agents can leave or join. So for different reasoning, first of all, maintenance purposes, it can be of interest to know how many active nodes there are in the network, okay? So by generalizing the work of Baragnolo, Pilloneto, and Scanato reported in equation 11, these authors applied static max consensus and statistical analysis in order to infer an estimation on the cardinality of the network. So we have generalized our protocol to open multi-agent system and then applied a similar strategy to reference 11 to estimate a size of a time-varying network. you can find more details about this on our work on archive.
Okay, thank you. Thank you, Diego. Let's see if we have some questions because we're running late.
Sorry.
Any questions from the audience? I see that Laura was asking for your slides and somebody answered that these are available. But then Laura left. I don't see her in the audience. Okay. Well, oh, here, there's one message. Ah, yeah, you're there, Laura. So I don't see
you. Sì, sono sempre qui. Ciao.
Ciao, Laura.
No, dicevo, sorry, English. If you can send me the archive address on email, please, because on the web.
Sure, sure. I'll take note of that.
Thank you, Laura.
Okay. Well, look, I think the time is almost over. I would,
I had a question
for Diego about some motivation. So that, you know, the last slide was a perfect answer in my question. You know, I was thinking, you know, what are the applications and so on. So I think we can close this session. Thank you all for attending. I think it's been a very interesting and multifold session on different applications on multi-agent systems. And, you know, I hope that you guys are going to be able to enjoy the rest of the CIDRA meeting. It would be nice to see you in person. Unfortunately, we have to do it this way, at least for some time.